And then he encodes all these queries. So he sends to Alice the encoded queries A. And then we want to have the compiler to be somewhat flexible enough to allow Alice to evaluate some functions. And finally, Bob can decode the evaluated encoding he read and retrieve back Alice's answers. So this procedure we call a spookify compiler, which has an encoding algorithm, an evaluation algorithm, an encoding algorithm. And we want to have, on the one hand, flexibility enough to allow Alice to evaluate these functions. But on the other hand, we want it to be somewhat secure enough so that whatever a malicious Alice could do could always be expressed as local functions. So after decoding, we want to have the guarantee that still each answer depends only on the respective question. So spookify compilers have been implicit in previous works. And specifically, the following idea was suggested. So for encoding, Bob is going to sample any dependent keys. And he's going to encrypt each query under the different key. And here, Bob is going to use a fully homomorphic encryption scheme. Now, since the scheme is fully homomorphic, this allows Alice, in turn, to evaluate the function on each of the ciphertexts. So, at the end, Bob can just decrypt each of the evaluated ciphertexts. And since this is a fully homomorphic encryption scheme, we get that each answer is the resulting function that Alice computed. And this is somewhat tempting to think that since we have the security of the encryption scheme, then all that Alice could do is just apply some local functions, because homomorphic encryption scheme allows evaluation functions and use independent public keys, so we could hope that Alice could not somehow mix the ciphertext together. And as might have been suggested, this is not the case. And in a work by Morgenthau, they showed that the security of the encryption scheme is insufficient to imply this locality property that we want. So kind of using the technical terms, the security of the encryption schemes allows a property that is called non-signaling. It means that each answer cannot, the distribution of each answer cannot depend on the other queries. So it's just a technical name. And functions that are not signaling, but also not local, we call spooky functions. And we want to avoid this kind of spooky function, so this is called a spooky free compiler. You hear the source for the name. And more recently, there was a specific, an explicit Gartner example, and they showed a fully homomorphic encryption scheme that even though you encrypt your ciphertext under different public keys, still a malicious Alice could evaluate functions that are not local. And they completed the result with constructing a spooky-free compiler, but the construction was based on knowledge assumption. So here's the formal definition of a spooky inference. So we define it using two experiments. The first one, which we call the real experiment, has a parameter A, and it goes like this. So Bob communicates with the adversary, and first he samples the key and sends to the adversary the encoding of the queries. Then the adversary can try and model the encoding and generate some evaluated encoding he tried. So finally, the result of this experiment, so we have the queries both encoded and then decoded answers. So with the second experiment that we have, which we call the simulated experiment, it's sort of the ideal way. So in this experiment, Bob doesn't talk to just one adversary, he talks to an independent simulators. And the communication goal, like we started with, and this is kind of the ideal simulation that we want. So Bob sends all his queries, and then all the simulators send their answers, and the simulators cannot communicate with each other. And similarly, the output of this experiment is again all the queries, and the answer that Bob got. And we say that the spooky-free compiler is spooky-free if for every adversary for the first experiment and for every distinguisher side that tries to distinguish between the first one and the second one, there always exists some simulator that whatever side can understand from the real experiment can always be simulated with some simulator S. So this definition captures exactly what we wanted. And it showed that whatever an adversary could do could always be expressed by this local simulator S. And since the simulators cannot communicate with each other, then the functionality that they could apply is always local. So this is the definition. And here's the main motivation for constructing such a spooky free compiler. So when we speak about MP-delegation, we consider the following. So this is the communication between a verifier and a prover, and they want to decide whether an instance X is an NLP language hall. So in the honest settings, we assume that also the prover knows the rules. And communication goes in two rounds. So first, the verifier send the query to the prover, then the prover has to come up with an answer, and then the verifier needs to decide whether X is a language or not. And we want the following properties. We want completeness, meaning that if the instance is in the language, then in the honest settings, the verifier would always accept. But we also want soundness, meaning that if X is not in the language, then for every efficient but adversarial prover P, the verifier would always reject with high enough probability. And we can consider two flavors of soundness. And in the first one, which is the more common one, we first assume that first the instance is set. Only then do the verifier send its queries. So the instance is independent of the verifier's queries, and this setting is called a selective soundness. But we can also consider a different flavor of soundness, where first the verifier has to send its queries, and then the adversary could choose the instance. So the instance could depend adversarially on the queries. So this is a stronger notion of soundness, which we call adaptive. And last but not least, the most important property that we want is we want the whole communication and the whole protocol to be very succinct. Specifically, we want the length of the queries and the answer to be sublinear in the length of the weakness, because otherwise this sort of protocol becomes trivial. And there are a few known constructions for such a delegation scheme, but all known constructions are either based on the random article model or on based on knowledge assumptions. And there are no known constructions from standard assumptions, say factoring or LWE or a more common assumption than knowledge assumptions. But if we slightly change the settings, then things come much better. Then it is known that if the verifier is allowed to talk with any independent provers, and again we assume that each prover knows the weakness, then if we again have two rounds of communication, where first the verifier sends all his queries, then the prover has to give answers. So if we assume that the prover cannot communicate with each other, then there is a known theorem that there exists just such protocols that are complete, that are unconditionally sound, and that are very succinct, specifically the communication is called algorithm. So this is the main motivation, and the idea is to take one of these multi-prover protocols and to use the spooky free compiler to compile all the protocol into a single prover sequence. So specifically, we're going to have something like this. So first, the verifier is going to sample an encoding key and queries for the multi-prover protocol, and it's going to send the encoded queries to the prover. Then the prover is going to evaluate the proofs, and again, the proofs come from the multi-prover protocol. And finally, the verifier simply has to encode and to retrieve back the answers. And it can prove that this resolving delegation protocol is also sound. And why is that? And since we used a spooky-free compiler, then all that an adversarial could do could always be expressed as a local simulator. And local simulators, or any local adversaries, is exactly what our first multi-prover is sound against. So whatever an adversarial could do could always be described by local functions, and our multi-prover protocol is sound against that. And this gives us selective soundness. And it's an open question if we could get actually an adaptive soundness, and I'll not go into it, but it's very not clear, and it doesn't seem too likely that this protocol would also be adaptively sound. So what we showed in our work is the following. So we have two results on spooky free compilers, and the first one is sort of the positive, And it shows that if you allow the evaluated encoding to be exponentially long in the length of the answers, then we can actually construct such spooky-free compilers from any FHE. However, if you look at this result, you see that the resulting delegation scheme is not succinct anymore, and in fact, it's quite brutal. So this shows that even though we can define spooky-free compilers without talking about delegation, it seems that these two notions are somehow connected. And talking about spooky-free compilers in a very large range of parameters is kind of sort of easy. And for the second result, we have some bad news, and we show a negative result. So if you try to have evaluated queries that are slightly shorter than that, then we have a black box operation. So our black box operation is from any falsifiable assumption, and I explain what falsifiable assumptions are in just a few slides. So for now, you can just think of it as factoring or a Diffie-Hellman assumption or LWE. And in fact, we show something that is a bit stronger. And even if you consider a spooky-free compiler with a restricted functionality, and if you want for the evaluation to support essentially a single function, or the encoding to encode queries coming for a specific distribution, then our negative results still apply. So what are black box operations? So say that they want to show to you that if we assume that factoring is hard, then my spooky-free compiler is indeed spooky-free. Equivalently, you can say that if you give me a spooky adversary, then I can construct from it an algorithm that solves factoring efficiently. And this looks something like that. So I have my reduction, and my reduction takes an input and an adversary. And if indeed you give me an adversary, then I can construct an algorithm with given a large integer n factors. So it is usually the settings where my reduction uses only oracle access to my adversary. So this sort of reduction is called a black box reduction. And we show that you cannot construct a black box reduction based on factoring, and you can replace factoring with any assumption that could be described as a gain between the challenger and the adversary. And these kind of assumptions are called falsifiable assumptions. So we show that you cannot construct a spooky-free compiler with a black box reduction based on any falsifiable assumption. So this is the high-level proof. So our starting point was a known impossibility result by Jen Jimix, and they showed the black box operation for adaptive validation. And their proof goes something like this. So we start with an inefficient adversary A. And since we allow the adversary to be inefficient, then it can be shown that there always exists such an adversary. Then for the second step, we simulate this inefficient adversary A with an efficient one A tilde. Now, A tilde does not necessarily break the soundness of the delegation protocol. However, to the eyes of the reduction, it cannot tell whether it's communicating with A or with A tilde. Now, since our inefficient adversary A breaks the soundness, and then we have the guarantee that on the left-hand side, this also breaks the assumption, say it could break factoring. Now, since the reduction cannot tell whether it's interacting with A or with A tilde, we get that also R that has access to A tilde also breaks the assumption. However, A tilde is an efficient algorithm, and the reduction is also efficient, then we get that you could also break the assumption efficiently, which is a contradiction. So this is the result by Jenkins. And we want to apply these sort of ideas in our settings. Since spooky-free compilers also imply delegation, we could hope to also apply this sort of ideas. However, we have two problems. First, the impossibility result by Jenkins apply only in the adaptive settings. And as I said, spooky-free compilers all guarantee also just selective sums. And it's not known if you could extend the result by Jenkins to the selective settings. But we also have more inherent problem. So the main idea of the second step of Jenkins is to simulate the inefficient adversary N with an efficient one A tilde. And simulating should sound bad when considering spooky-free encryption, because this is the exact opposite of what we want. So if we set the simulator to be A tilde, and get an efficient simulator that simulates our adversary A. And this is the exact opposite of the definition of a spooky-free compiler. So this is not spooky. So we can think I just start for the first step to construct an even efficient algorithm that breaks this weakness. So here's our solution. We allow the adversary A in the distinguisher psi to share some outcoded string signal. And we are going to construct signal like that. So for every simulator, it cannot simulate signal. And the important thing is that notice that we have psi of sigma on two sides of the sort of equations. So even though we replace the adversary with the simulator S, it still has to convince our distinguisher psi, and psi has this very complicated string sigma, which doesn't allow any simulators to simulate. So if our adversary cannot be simulated, it means that it's spooky. And we are back to the business, since if it is spooky, then the reduction given black box access to the adversary and the distinguisher, it could break the assumption. And the second step is also similar to the one by John Tuwicks, and it's just to simulate our adversary. And for simulation, we replace sigma with another string sigma tilde, and now sigma tilde, along with a slight modification for A and psi, allows us to simulate A and psi. And again, since the reduction cannot tell whether she is talking to the efficient or the inefficient adversary, then we get that also R given to the efficient adversary also breaks the assumption. So again, we get an algorithm that is efficient and breaks the assumption. It's a contradiction. So I have a few more slides and 5 minutes left. So can I continue? Sure. So, so I'll sketch to you on a very high level how our construction looks like. So we start with defining two languages, L and L bar, and L is simply going to be the image of a pseudorandom generator, and L bar is anything that is not a language. And since we assume that this is a pseudorandom generator, then L is indistinguishable from L bar. And how is our episode is going to look like? So we have a reduction. We have the adversary and we have psi the distinguisher, and we promised a common string sigma, and sigma is going to be this string, where we simply sample n independent samples of indices that are not in the language. So, what is the adversary? The reduction set encodings, and the adversary viewed these encodings as encoding of a multiprover and protocol. So what does it do then? Then it samples an index between 1 and n, and sends a fake proof for that instance x bar sub i. And there always exists just a fake proof, seeing we assume that e prime is xint, and it's also known as the dense modulus theorem. So all in all, our inefficient adversary is going to send a fake proof in the index I. And then the distinguisher is given the queries, the decoded answer in index, simply looks at the ith instance of this and the string signal, and he verifies using the multiprover protocol whether x bar sub I and the queries and answer are indeed a valid proof, and then he sends the answer. So very quickly, why this spooky adversary? So here we have that A sends fake proof, and Psi verifies this proof, and since these are fake proof, then the verifier accepts high probability. However, when we consider any simulator, by definition we have that the simulator is local, and for any index that we choose, we always have the instance is not in language. So in order for the simulator to make psi output 1, it must output an accepting proof for the instance not in language. And since the simulator is local, it cannot do that simply because of the summons of the multiprover protocol. So we get that the simulator cannot simulate this view. Very, very quickly, our efficient adversary is done by simply replacing our string sigma with indices that are in the language. So we sample x to be in the image of the pseudorandom generator, and we also have the weakness. And now A could simply generate honest proofs for the instance, and Psi continue to verify. And finally, we kind of have to tweak A and Psi a little bit to get that these two things are indeed in distinction. And so this is it, and thank you very much.
Okay, let's have a speaker.